Hello and welcome once again to It's Your Money. I'm Eric Landskroner. This week, we kick things off with mental toughness and money. For that, I'd like to welcome Steve Siebold, motivational speaker who has made a career out of helping Fortune 500 companies increase their sales through mental toughness training. He's the author of the book, How Rich People Think. It's a book which he says isn't about money. It's all about thinking. Steve, we thank you for joining us on the show.
Thanks, Eric.
Looking forward to hearing what you have to say. But first, we want to get to your website. The website says that tough times require tough people, and right now certainly would qualify as tough times. We've been in them for the past couple of years already. Talk about the book, though, because you talk about 100 ways that rich people think differently than maybe middle class people. So what would be one of the most common ways, or maybe the first way that you mentioned in the book?
Probably overall, Eric, it's fear. It's that most of us are trained to think about money in terms of fear and scarcity and hoarding it and hoping we have enough for retirement, whereas the wealthy, the rich, are thinking about money in terms of opportunity, abundance, possibility, liberty, freedom, all the good things.
So you have saving money versus earning money, I guess.
Well, the average person earns $42,000 a year in America. And at 2 or 3 or 4% interest, you have to save for a long time to really accumulate even a small fortune. So the rich focus on earning, and that way they don't have to make the big killing with their investments. Very smart strategy.
Yeah, and right now, as you mentioned, the interest out there is almost non-existent.
Yeah, you're better off putting it in your mattress almost. Not really, but almost.
Of course, you heard that story not too long ago about the person who asked their daughter threw out their mattress when they were gone for the day.
Yeah, wow.
That wouldn't be a good thing. All right, so linear thinking versus non-linear thinking. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, the rich think about money in terms of non-linear terms. In other words, they're thinking about it in terms of how can they take an idea and transform that into solid cash? Whereas most of us are thinking in linear terms. I work so many hours, I make so many dollars. If I get a raise, I can make more money, and that's kind of the only way I can do it, or get a different job that pays more. That's linear versus non-linear.
All right, so the middle class might, in the book you mentioned, the middle class looks at wealth, and they say, well, hard work creates wealth. What do the rich think of?
They think thinking creates wealth. In other words, not just thinking alone. I don't mean in that sense, but I mean they think of ideas that create solutions to solve problems, and then they cash it in.
Money. We've heard it before. Money is the root of all evil. That's the way a lot of people think. Is it not the way that the rich think?
It's the root of all freedom, all liberty and comfort and good night's sleep.
Okay, but in the book you also mentioned that the rich might think of it as the root of, the poverty is the root of all evil then.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I've had no money. I'm not sure about you, but most of us have been broke at one point. I spent a fair amount of time there. It's not a great place to be. I mean, it stresses you out. It causes sickness, and money can even save your life if you need some kind of operation. I mean, you don't hear the wealthy complaining about their health care plan. Really?
Being rich is a privilege. That's something that that you mentioned as something that middle class thinks of. What would the wealthy think?
They think it's a right. The rich think it's their right. Not in terms of entitlement, but in terms of they think in America you have the right to be rich. It's what the whole country and the whole economy was founded on.
All right, so there are so many ways that the rich, the middle class, the rich and the non-rich or not wealthy differ in thought, differ in the way they look at money. So how do you get the two to converge a little bit? How do you get the middle class to start thinking the other way?
I think the first thing you do is you learn how the rich think and how it differs, if it does, from how you think. That's when I started interviewing rich people 26 years ago, Eric. I thought, well, they just got lucky, you know, or they're blue bloods, or you know, something like that. And then I realized it's like they're thinking completely differently than I am, and that's why I'm broke and they're rich. And then I started adopting their beliefs, their philosophies, their habits, their actions, their behaviors, and the money started to flow.
What do you think, what action or what philosophy helps more than anything else?
I think looking at money in terms of money is your friend. Money is not a necessary evil. It's something that can change your life. It's not going to make you any happier, but it'll make you more comfortable. It'll give you opportunities. It'll give your kids opportunities they can barely even dream of right now.
How do you adapt all of this to speaking to Fortune 500 companies?
Well, I think I try to teach them a consciousness, a level of consciousness when it comes to money, because again, I think most of us, no matter how smart or educated someone is, they're operating for the most part, if they don't have a lot of money, at a low level of consciousness or awareness in terms of just money. They could be the smartest person in the world, but if they don't have money, chances are they're thinking about it at a lower level. So I try to get organizations to think about, sales teams mostly, to think about money at a higher level of consciousness, which opens up the idea that money is abundant. It's all over the place, even in the biggest recession in our lifetime.
Wow. And right now, you've been on, what, a 50-state tour?
Right, 50-city tour. Around the world.
Okay, and now you're headed to where next?
I'm headed to Philadelphia tomorrow, then Atlanta the next day.
That It's pretty incredible. And then and you're heading to Australia soon.
Although it ends in Sydney in late November.
All right. So, listen, so many things for people to keep in mind. And you have clients, once again, all across the spectrum, including Johnson & Johnson, based right here in New Jersey. What would you say is the biggest challenge that any of these companies has faced?
I think probably overcoming limited thoughts, limited thinking. In other words, it's a recession, there's no money out there, the consumers don't have any money, and it's absolutely not true. The money is all over the place.
All right, Steve Siebel, thank you so much for your insight.
Thanks, Eric. I appreciate it.
Thank you for coming on the show.